STEM fans, are you ready? Let's hear it for the world-class NASA STEM Stars team. From NASA centers across the country, we present Ann Richards, Eduardo Lopez, and Chelsea Partridge.
And I'm coming to you live from Kennedy Space Center. I'm joined by my co-host, Samuel Garcia, and our panelists, and we are so excited you're here. You are the Artemis generation, so we want you to pay attention because this is going to be awesome. So if you have questions along the way, please put them in the chat, and we will make sure we answer them at the end. So I'm going to turn it over to Samuel.
Thank you, Lynn, for that awesome introduction. So yes, today we are joined by three past NASA STEM Stars Artemis miniseries guests. We got Chelsea Partridge with Lockheed Martin, Ann Richards with Jacobs, and of course, Eduardo Lopez with Boeing. So these three individuals have been working so hard helping NASA prepare for the Artemis 1 mission. And so we're excited to hear them about all their experiences and their work with this mission.
Right. Let's get started. I'm going to start with Chelsea, and she's going to tell you a little bit about herself, and then we'll go through everyone. Go ahead, Chelsea.
Thanks, Lynn. Hi, everyone. I'm Chelsea Partridge, and I'm the production process verification lead for the Orion spacecraft. I work at Lockheed Martin here at Kennedy Space Center. And a fun fact about me is I love the game Dungeons & Dragons, and I play it every week with my coworkers.
Awesome. All right, we'll go to Eduardo now.
Hey, good afternoon, everyone. My name is Eduardo Lopez. I work with the Boeing Company supporting Space Launch System on the core stage. And my support for that is as the main propulsion system technical lead engineer, making sure that everything in the core stage meets the component requirements. Fun fact about me, I was actually the liquid oxygen console operator for the Green Run test series. So really, really rewarding experience there and fun experience.
Awesome. And then we'll finally start with Ann. Go ahead.
Hi, so I'm Ann Richards, and I am the arms and umbilical subject matter expert for the ground systems. I work at Jacobs, and a fun fact about myself is that I have the same birthday as my mom.
Awesome. Thank you, everyone, for those wonderful introductions. So now it's time to learn more about Artemis 1 by watching this brief video.
We are at Kennedy Space Center. Every piece of hardware necessary to return to the moon is now here.
They are being assembled, stacked, fueled, and primed for flight.
Next time these engines fire up, we'll be on the launch pad to send an uncrewed Orion spacecraft around the moon on a flight test for the Artemis 1 mission.
It's been a journey of 1,000 miles from factory floors all across this country and around the world to here. And now the stage has been set.
We are seeing Artemis take her place.
The framework to support the enormity of this moment can't be measured in renovations and rehearsals alone.
But in the testing of a metal found much deeper.
With each segment built upon the one before it. The volume of anticipation can be seen rising.
For in addition to certifying what a host of testing has already previewed,
the dawn of Orion and a new era of American space exploration.
Artemis will demonstrate a new path to the moon for this generation.
Artemis 1.
An uncrewed test flight will be a final proving of every system
and every component
in the harshness of space.
A mission that, when successful, will open the door for the moonwalkers and lunar experiments
that so many have hoped and dreamed about.
We are going.
Wow. I get chills every time I watch that one. So awesome. We did see that in this video, it's Artemis 1 is a collaborative effort between all kinds of partners. So what are we trying to do? We're trying to get back to the moon. So Anne, can you provide us a quick overview of what is the Artemis mission?
Yeah, Lynn. So Artemis is NASA's new lunar human exploration program that will put the first woman and the first person of color on the surface of the moon. So NASA partners with, a lot of American companies like Boeing, Lockheed Martin, Jacobs, my company, and thousands of others, in addition to some international partners, in order to work towards the goal of having a long-term presence on the surface of the moon. And we're going to learn from being there and our work around the moon in order to make the next giant leap, and that's to get astronauts to Mars.
Thanks, Anne. That's exciting when we just even consider about that. Now we're going back to the moon and onto Mars eventually. So my question is for Chelsea. Chelsea, can you tell us specifically what is the purpose of Artemis 1?
Sure. So there are a few objectives of the Artemis 1 mission, the first of which is being actually testing the spacecraft out in space before we fly a crew to the moon. So we do lots of testing here at Kennedy Space Center and in other places across the country to test out Orion before we fly to make sure it's safe. But there's nothing like actually doing it in space for the first time. So we want to do that, number one. We'll also be testing out the heat shield for lunar reentry conditions. We also have payloads on board, CubeSats and other payloads that we are going to be launching to test out. And then finally, retrieval. So when Orion splashes down in the ocean, we have to go get it. And that's another part that we want to test out before we actually have crew on board the spacecraft.
Awesome overview. It's going to be exciting. So I have a question for Eduardo. Give us a little bit of a breakdown of the SLS rocket, our Space Launch System rocket, and its capabilities. What makes it different from other rockets that we use in space travel?
Sure. So to give you an idea, I have a model here of the Block 1 configuration of the SLS rocket. Starting from the top to the bottom, the top we have the launch abort system, Orion and its capsule and its service module, everything here. You get down into the interim cryogenic propulsion stage, or ICPS as we call it. There is a launch vehicle stage adapter right here that attaches the top of the vehicle to what we call the core stage. And within the core stage are the two propellant tanks, oxygen on top, hydrogen in the bottom. We have the SRBs on the side, and the tanks here in the middle feed the RS-25 engines that are in the bottom, providing 2 million pounds of thrust. So in terms of the vehicle itself, almost everything is new. We did use some heritage components. Of course, the SRBs are from heritage components. We just increased the number of segments from 4 to 5. And then the RS-25 engines in the bottom, of course, those came directly from the Space Shuttle program. We are using that same hardware among other components within the propulsion system that we could reuse here for SLS. And of course, in terms of capability, I mean, this vehicle itself gives you the most payload capability to the moon surface, right? Up to 3 times more than anything available right now. And on top of giving you that capability, it gives you evolvability too. So going over from the block one configuration crew to cargo, we will also start, or next year we're starting to build the block 1B configuration, which will have an exploration upper stage instead of the ICPS. And then we have a block 2 that gives you a lot more capability. So in terms of payload capability, you're talking between 27 metric tons all the way to above 43 metric tons to the lunar surface. So there's just nothing out there that can compare to this vehicle at the moment. And that's why it is so different. Biggest differences between this and previous vehicles is that this vehicle is the first one where the first one we produced was used for testing and for certification of the design. It's also being used for the first flight. We have never done that before, and we have gone through a successful green run. So that's all I have.
Eduardo, that's a truly great breakdown as to the Artemis 1 rocket and its different components. And you mentioned that Orion is a critical piece in this rocket, in this mission. So my question is for Chelsea. When we look at Orion specifically, it kind of reminds us a lot of the Apollo era spacecraft. Can you tell us what the differences and similarities are between both spacecraft?
Sure. So let's start with the similarities, and then we'll go into a little bit of the differences between the two spacecraft. So the most obvious similarity between the two are the shape. They have the same blunt body design, that capsule shape that's very iconic. And the reason for that is, well, the laws of physics in the 1960s and the laws of physics of today are the same. And that's just a very efficient capsule design for space reentry. But some of the differences, for me, one of the really big major differences, if I was an astronaut, is that Orion has a toilet, which Apollo did not. And so I think that'll make the trip a bit more comfortable for our astronauts. Orion's also capable of carrying a more diverse group of astronauts. It has the capability, the seats and the suits have the capability to fit 99% of the human population. From people in heights from 4'10" to 6'5". The Apollo era was much more limited in the size of people that it could carry. Orion can carry 4 astronauts. I think Apollo was just limited to 3. And also, we think about the technology, even though the design is the same in terms of the shape of the capsule, technology has come a really long way from the 1960s to now. So Orion has much more advanced computing capacities. It's many thousands times more capable in terms of computing speeds and such stuff like that.
All right, so that was an excellent overview. Thank you for that. So the next question I have is for Anne. So Kennedy Space Center is obviously, we're here today. I don't know if you guys know, but we're actually here at Kennedy Space Center. You can see the VAB behind us, but it's changed a lot over the years. So can you tell us a little bit about the changes and updates for our newest mission, our Artemis mission?
Yeah, so the ground systems team made a lot of updates in preparation for Artemis 1. So we've talked a little bit about the rocket, and it sits on top of our mobile launcher tower. And that has, you know, all of the connections and all of the fueling and all of the electrical connections for the rocket. Well, that is in the vehicle assembly building behind me right now and needs to move out to the launch pad for launch. So in order to do so, we have a crawler transporter that sits underneath and lifts the entire structure and rocket up and relocates it to the pad. That crawler transporter had an increased carrying capacity with our refurbishment from 12 million to 18 million pounds carrying capacity. So an insane increase right there. And that's in order to move, you know, our integrated rocket with the Orion capsule and the whole mobile launcher tower out the 4 miles between our building where we assemble and then to the launch pad. Now, the vehicle assembly building also had some upgrades. We put in new platforms in order to interface with the rocket. And so that was the main thing. We built some stands that built onto top of the platforms. And then at the launch pad, this is actually a historic launch pad, launch pad 39B, and was used for a lot of the space shuttle missions. We cleaned off the pad. We got rid of all of the heritage equipment out there, put in new propellant lines, new tanks for our cryogenics. We, built up new flame trenches and lightning tower updates, just a lot of system updates out there at the pad. And then last but not least, we had updates to the Launch Control Center. That's the building just right next to the Vehicle Assembly Building. There we got new information technology, we got new software updates, and some new consoles. And with those updates, we actually have the capability of processing 575,000 data samples per second, in addition to 328 commands per second. So these upgrades are wonderful for our Artemis program and will increase the opportunity for, the years to come.
Wow, that's incredible just to learn the fascinating history, the evolution here of the center to prepare for Artemis and Artemis One. So my question is for Eduardo. Eduardo, the three of you all work for different companies supporting NASA and the Artemis mission. We want to know how many other companies work with you on this specific mission.
So with the Boeing company, we have actually worked with over just about 1,000 companies since the inception of the program about a decade ago. We currently have about 400 on contract supporting us for future missions, for future hardware that we are building. But in terms of Artemis and the whole SLS program, I mean, NASA has worked with thousands of industry partners, across the 50 states here in America, and also other parts of the world. We have men and women across, like I said, the United States and across the world, building the systems to support missions to the moon, Mars and beyond. And one important thing to note here is that you don't necessarily have to be working at a NASA center to support the space program. I mean, just within the Boeing company, we have people working virtually from Cleveland all the way to California, Seattle, Houston, and of course in Florida and here in Huntsville, Alabama.
Very good. Thank you. And then we do have a visual you guys can see right here. All of these companies are throughout the United States and Europe. And I'm going to ask this question to Chelsea. How are the spacecraft and rocket pieces actually shipped and assembled?
So if you were paying attention to the video earlier, you already should know the answer to some of this because some of it was shown. But the pieces of Orion and the SLS rocket come in a variety of ways. The coolest, in my opinion, which you did see in the video, is the Super Guppy aircraft, which is one of the most interesting looking planes you'll ever see, capable of carrying a entire crew module in it. The European service module for Orion also comes on the Antonov airplane from Europe to the United States. We have pieces of the rocket, the solid rocket boosters, that come via rail from Utah to Florida. And we have the Pegasus barge, which leaves from a chute assembly facility right outside of New Orleans and comes to Florida with the other parts of the SLS rocket. And then we even have pieces that come through the mail and on truck. So you don't even think about that, but there are components that make their way to Kennedy Space Center that way as well. So pretty much any way you think of transportation, pretty much just everything but submarine, I guess.
We have it here. That's awesome. Thank you.
Awesome, Chelsea. And as we see in the Vehicle Assembly Building, all these parts are here, right? And so my question is for Anne. And once you receive, you and your team receive all these completed parts for the spacecraft, for the rocket, what are the next steps?
So the ground systems team actually, accepts and has to check out each of the flight hardware components that get here. So they're not completely ready to be assembled by the time that they arrive at Kennedy Space Center. We do initial processing, fueling of the different components, and then the checkout. And that's across multiple facilities throughout Kennedy Space Center. After all of that is complete for each of the components, then they finally get relocated to the Vehicle Assembly Building, as you mentioned, behind us. into the aisle in the center, and they actually get lifted up into place by one of the five overhead cranes. And so, you know, this building behind us is over 500 feet tall. It's, you know, about 3.5 times the size of the Empire State Building. So, you know, over 3 Empire State Buildings can fit inside there. So each of these components needs to be lifted up over the walkways that run past the high bays in that building and then into place on top of the mobile launcher tower. And so we have the solid rocket boosters that were integrated first, and then the core stage on top of that. And we work our way up to the vehicle adapter, the interim cryogenic propulsion system, all the way up to Orion and the abort system. And so once that happens, there's integration testing that has to happen for the full system. This is the first time that these pieces are installed together, that they're connected electronically, that they are talking to our Kennedy Space Center systems, to our launch control system. So we have multiple tests that go into this process. We have the interface verification testing, and that is powering up each of the separate components. So Orion gets powered up separately, the interim cryogenic propulsion system gets powered up separately, the core stage, and then you know, there's health and status tests that go into that as well. We also do testing on the radio frequency and making sure that all of the commands that are going from our launch control center can be read correctly and everything is healthy. So after all of this testing happens in our vehicle assembly building, it will actually, the entire integrated system will roll out to our launch pad where wet dress rehearsal will happen.
Awesome. Awesome. So it's a lot to have. And so when it gets out there, she did mention, this next question is for Eduardo. She mentioned the wet dress rehearsal. Can you tell us a little bit about what that entails?
Sure. So the wet dress rehearsal, just from a very direct objective, we're trying to make sure that the vehicle, the rocket, integrates well with the ground system, right? Everything that is being sent to the vehicle and from the vehicle to the ground. So to expand on that, we create a very extensive procedure or set of almost like a recipe, right? If you're baking something and you have to follow that recipe to us comes through operational maintenance requirements that we have to follow. So we tested all this at Green Run. We had a different ground system that paved the way in defining the loading procedures, the conditioning procedures of that propellant so that we can get it in the right conditions so that we can start the engines. So we're doing this at KSC to make sure that with the EGS ground system, those same procedures or procedures that were slightly changed or updated based on differences between the ground systems, to make sure that those integrate well and that all the conditions for the propellant as we're loading it and running it through the engines, to make sure that those conditions are perfect right before engine start. We're gonna go through the whole loading procedure. We're gonna start with the pneumatic actuation, so making sure all the helium gets into the system. We're gonna start loading the LO2 or the liquid oxygen first, conditioning that system, going into the hydrogen loading as well, making sure that those two propellants densify to the right propellant conditions that we need. And then after that, we're going to make sure that the temperature and the pressure conditions at the engine interface are at the right conditions so that we can start the engines. Before we start the engines, we cut off that test. We call it complete. We hopefully everything goes well. And from there, it's just a matter of draining the propellant that is left on so that we can save the vehicle, send it back into the VAV, and then hopefully, refurbish it and come back to launch.
Wow. Thanks for describing that crucial and important step, Eduardo. And so we're going to put Chelsea here on the spot. Oh, we're sorry. But the question, and you knew it was coming, that the question that everybody wants to know, when will we launch Artemis 1?
My parents ask me that question all the time, too. You know, we have that wet dress rehearsal that has to come first. And after the wet dress rehearsal, NASA should be setting a launch date. And I don't have a date, but I can say early 2022.
All right. So we're all excited about that. Early 2022. Everyone heard that. So tune in. And Anne, can you talk and can you just walk us through an actual launch day? What's going to happen on launch day?
So one of the tricky parts about launch day is, you know, this is the first launch where we'll have the full integrated system. So this is the, we're really dealing with the level of detail for checking all of the systems and keeping track of that. So we're tracking the critical temperature, we're tracking the pressure for all of the different components in there after fueling and everything. And so in our firing room, which is what we call where all of launch control will be sitting and monitoring all of these values, there's 95 people who are doing that between Jacobs and NASA. And so they are keeping track of everything for the rest of us. But on the actual like vehicle side and hardware side, so during launch day, you know, we fuel up the rocket in the last 48 hours. And so all of that is being monitored. There's the electrical connections, and I told you a little bit about that on December 1st, talking about the arms and umbilicals. During that last 48 hours, the vehicle actually has to go to internal power. So in preparation for the arms to be released, to be moved out of the way for launch. Additionally, we're launching the most powerful rocket ever built, and so it's going to go actually Mach 23 or 17,000 miles per hour at max speed during launch, which is just absolutely crazy. And in order to do that, we have some structural components that we added out at the launch pad. So we have these extensible columns that go underneath the mobile launcher tower, and the flame trenches are moved into place as well. So there's just things that happen at the pad in the last 48 hours that you wouldn't necessarily expect. And so there's a lot that goes into those last hours before launch that to make the entire thing come together.
Wow, that's fantastic. Just to, you know, help us understand preparing for a launch and what that entails. So thanks for sharing that, Anne. My question is for Eduardo. So once Artemis 1 launches, how does the rocket know when to move to each stage of that launch?
So the rocket has what we call like the brain, and in this case it's the computer that holds the flight software. That flight software receives information from thousands of measurements, and those measurements can include things from accelerometers to passive pressure and temperature sensors to high frequency pressure oscillation sensors, those type of things. And the computer, or in this case the flight software, based on those readings, we'll identify the position of the vehicle and the delta velocity of the vehicle. From measurements from the SRBs, it'll be able to tell when it's getting to the depletion of those. And at about 120 seconds, it lets go of those SRBs. Then from there, it goes into the core stage or the RS-25 power for throughout the rest of the mission prior to getting to ICPS. But to get to all those points, like I said, it's receiving information and it's making decisions at about every 20 milliseconds. So that's 0.02 seconds that is receiving information from all these sensors. And it's taking all that information, knowing exactly where the vehicle is, it's essentially doing like a health status, seeing the position of the vehicle, the velocity of the vehicle, and then making changes either to engine throttle or in terms of separations.
All right, so that's one smart rocket. I'll tell you, that's really fascinating. My next question: once this rocket is in space and Orion officially is out there, will there be any science experiments that you might want to share with us, Chelsea?
Yeah. So, well, first off, Orion's going to be out there for about 3 weeks, and in addition to what we talked about earlier in terms of wanting to test Orion out, there will be science payloads on board. So there will be about 10 CubeSats or Cube satellites that will be launched from Orion out to space. Those will have several different kinds of experiments that they're doing with the moon and other parts of our space environment. On board Orion, there will be a moonikin, which is a mannequin, and it will be outfitted with different sensors to try to collect crew data, to try and figure out different things that the crew might experience when they are on Orion and in space. And there will also be a couple of torsos. Helga and Zohar are their names, and they will be outfitted with radiation sensors. Radiation is a big problem in space, and so that will kind of give us a good idea of the radiation that astronauts will see when they are on board.
That's awesome. That's great. It's great to learn about some of the innovation and technologies aboard Orion and during this Artemis 1 test flight. So Chelsea, we're going back to you for this question. Upon reentry, we can expect, Orion will definitely encounter some really, really tough conditions. Can you tell us or describe to us as to some of those conditions this our spacecraft will be facing during reentry?
Sure. Reentry is an incredible environment in the sense that it is very harsh. It's very intense. Orion will be coming back in at 25,000 miles per hour. With that amount of speed, if you were flying from Los Angeles to New York, you could do that in 6 minutes. I think the average flight for an airliner to do that is about 5.5 hours. So that'll kind of give you an idea of how fast 25,000 miles per hour really is. The force of friction from our atmosphere will slow Orion down to about 325 miles per hour, and then our parachute sequence will deploy. And there's several stages of parachutes that will slow Orion down when it's coming back in to a nice, soft, easy landing of about 20 miles per hour in the Pacific Ocean off the coast of California. And while we're doing all of this, in addition to the intense speeds, there's a lot of heat. So Orion will see temperatures of about 4,000 degrees Fahrenheit, which is twice as hot as the basaltic lava in Hawaii, just to give a little bit of perspective there.
Oh, those are great scenarios, or letting us know exactly, because I know a lot of the kids that are listening are wanting to know, how hot is that? How far is that? How fast is that? So thank you for that. So once it does splash down, this question is for Anne. The Kennedy Space Center Exploration Ground Systems has to recover it. So can you kind of talk a little bit about that recovery and what's involved in recovering Orion in the ocean?
So the Orion capsule will splash down over in the Pacific Ocean, pretty close to San Diego. And Jacob sends a team out there, you know, with engineers, logistics, a variety of teams to support, and we partner up with the Navy. We go out in a Navy ship and are at the splashdown location. There are some scuba divers that actually take a boat out, and then they go up close to the vehicle and they stabilize the vehicle and get it ready to be put on a winch and brought into the Navy boat. It goes onto a well deck and then hoisted up onto the deck and then shipped back over to Kennedy Space Center. So there's some processing that gets done at that point, making sure that there's no hazardous commodities on board still, and getting it refurbished.
Well, thanks for providing that great insight into the reentry process or the recovery process specifically. And so I have a question, and I think I'm going to put Eduardo on the spot for this one. Now, we know Artemis is just around the corner. And so looking ahead, when can we see the subsequent missions as part of Artemis and the eventual return to the moon?
Question. Artemis 1, we're hoping that we can get it launched in the next few months, right? Artemis 2, which will be our first crewed flight for astronauts, that will take place no earlier than 2023. And then Artemis 3, which will land the first woman and the first person of color in the surface of the moon, that can will take place no earlier than 2025. But those are not just plans. I mean, I would like to tell you that Core Stage 2 is currently being built at the Michoud Assembly Facility. So even though we have Core Stage 1 over there at KSC, we do have a lot of the hardware already being built for Core Stage 2, and that has seen a lot of great progress. We are starting to planning the receival of Core Stage 3 parts as well. So these are not just plans that we have on paper. We do have hardware that is being built for those different vehicles. And in addition to Core Stage 1, 2, and 3, we're already starting production on the exploration upper stage for core stage that will be used on core stage 4 mission. So again, these are things that are happening right now. They're not just on paper or just being planned.
Awesome. So I think we have some questions we're going to start taking. But before we do that, I just want to make sure after these student questions, we want to make sure you guys already are starting to think about this question. Where will you be for Artemis 1? So start thinking about that. But I think at this point, we're going to start taking questions.
That's right. So we heard from our panelists, so we want to hear from you all. What questions do you have for our special guests? So let's go to jump to the chat and start fielding some of these questions.
Thanks, guys, for these awesome questions. So Rachel wants to know, what do you wish students knew about Artemis 1 and what it means for them? We'll start with Chelsea or anyone that wants to take it.
Sure. One of the things I want to make sure students know is this Artemis 1 mission is not just the result of engineers and scientists. We have all sorts of people that are involved with creating this mission and making it happen. You saw these videos that were playing earlier and some of these graphics that are created by incredibly artistic people. We have people that work contracts. We have people that work supply chain and get those parts from around the country and around the world here to Kennedy Space Center. So, you know, when we think about space flight and we think about Artemis 1 and Orion, you know, we definitely think about the building the spacecraft and putting it all together and launching it. But we don't always think about all those other things. So something I want students to know is if you aren't really interested in the science or engineering side, and I hope you are, but if you're not, but you're really into space, there are still opportunities for you to be involved with something like Artemis, even if engineering or science isn't exactly your calling.
Great answer.
So that's a great a response to that, Chelsea. So now I want to ask Eduardo, we have a question for you from Patricia, who wants to know, how can teachers and students be a part of the Artemis mission?
There are many ways that they can be part of the Artemis mission. Students and teachers, you can start. There are many curriculums that we have put together or that NASA has put together, different activities that you can go and work and learn about the Artemis program itself. You can get involved in a lot of STEM activities as well. There's as many opportunities, and those opportunities are provided in many links, I think, that are on the NASA website. But yeah, definitely there are many ways to get involved with the Artemis mission, knowing exactly what it entails, everything that we're going to be doing, the different experiments and all the testing we're doing. But in addition to that, there are things that you can go and do in terms of hands-on activities that will really help you understand it better.
Excellent. Thank you so much, Eduardo. Another question we have, and I probably will put this towards Anne. Okay, so Patricia wants to know. Thanks, Patricia. You're very active in the chat, and I love that. It's hard to become an engineer. What do you need to do to get a job like you?
So I know that we talked a little bit about it at our other STEM Stars video, so feel free to watch some of those videos for a little bit more background. But, you know, it's just about taking opportunities and running with them. So if there's any opportunities in math and science locally at your schools or online, especially with COVID, I feel like there's a lot more online opportunities. So you can be learning about what's going on with NASA, what's going on with the Artemis program, and the other industries out there as well that would require engineers. And you can learn all of that just from your home. But any opportunities in your community and just taking advantage of them so that you can build your experiences and be ready to jump on an engineering opportunity if you end up going to college and doing engineering and graduating and doing that.
That's awesome advice, and thank you so much for sharing that. We have a specific question, and I'm going to turn it to any of the panelists here. Can you tell us more about the unique orbital trajectory the Artemis 1 mission will take? And thanks in advance, and ad astra. So I'm not sure if anybody who can answer that specific question.
Good one.
I can help. I mean, I'm so first of all, I am not a guidance, navigation, and control engineer, so don't take everything I say as gospel. But in terms of the orbital trajectory, it is way different than for example the Apollo missions, because this particular orbital trajectory will take us to the surfaces of the moon that are at both poles, right? The northern and southern pole. And the reason why we're doing those trajectories way differently is because we want to set a station or a way to get to the southern pole of the moon to be able to use the resources and understand the resources there a lot better, because we have found a very, very thick layer of ice there, right? So Apollo missions took us into orbital trajectories that primarily focused on the equator of the moon, with the ability of SLS to be able to give us a higher speed or a higher velocity, we can reach trajectories that'll take us to the poles of the moon. That's really the differences, or the difference between the orbital trajectory for SLS.
Awesome. Rocket science. There we go. So I'm going to go like Jack wants to know something. We have about 5 minutes left here, but Jack, this is a good question. How will the rocket stay upright when it moves out to the launch pad? Does it wobble?
So one of the interesting things is that the boosters actually hold the core stage upright. So if you're looking, the main connection, the boosters get stacked first, and then the core stage actually gets sat on top of the boosters at two points down close to the bottom of the boosters. And the boosters get pulled apart a little bit so that there's room for the core stage to get stacked down. When the vehicle is rolling out to the pad, we have something called a vehicle stabilizer, and that's one of the arms that goes from the mobile launcher to the core stage. That holds around the top of the core stage, and it does make sure that the vehicle is not moving too much. There is a little bit of wobble, and we also do have wind, of course, out at the launch pad especially. So we take all of that into account, and really the vehicle stabilizer arm is the thing that makes sure that the wobbling doesn't get to be too much right there.
Great question.
That's awesome. Great question and an awesome answer to that question. So we're going to do one more question, and it comes also from Jack. This one was really interesting. So who makes the final call to decide when the rocket is ready to launch?
Chelsea.
Okay. Well, that's our launch director, but day of, you know, there's 95 people in the control room, as I mentioned before, and each person runs a subsystem, is looking at different values, and everybody goes through down the line, and there's a call, are you go for launch? And once all of those people say, yes, the weather is good, the pressure reading is good, all of the other components are good, then the launch director will make that call.
Yay, awesome. And then
the launch director is Charlie Blackwell Thompson. Yes. She's the first woman to have that position.
I was just going to say that. You read my mind. So it's so exciting. The first female launch director. Mm-hmm. We're going to have launched this rocket, you guys. It's so exciting.
Launch director on a Artemis mission, on Artemis, which is named after a woman. And it'll take the first woman to the moon. I mean, that's like real girl power there.
There we go, girl power. I love it. I love it. So last question, I told you guys to think about this. This is a quick answer. Where will you be for the Artemis 1 launch?
I still haven't figured that out yet. So we'll see. I might be watching it here at Kennedy Space Center. I might be watching with my parents, or I might be working with the public for that launch. So I don't actually have to work the launch itself. So we'll see. I think I'll just get the opportunity to enjoy it from wherever that may be.
So I'll be representing Jacobs on center, so able to watch the launch from very close, but we have a lot of visitors coming through and a lot of people affiliated with the company, and so I'll be talking about launch day and about the rocket, so I'm very excited to meet all those people.
Thank you. And at last but not least, let's go with Eduardo.
And myself, so I will be at the processing control center there at KSC. I am one of the console support operators there from the Boeing company for the main propulsion system. So I will be there, and I'm hoping to take my whole family there. They'll probably be at Cocoa Beach, though.
Awesome. Okay. So we're at 1 minute. So I'm just saying, I'm just so excited. This is an awesome panel. And I just want to give you guys now, you guys are the Artemis generation. So I really want you guys to do some stuff for us. So we need you to get involved. So you'll see a slide that's going to come up very soon. And there's some things that we want you to do, and it'll also go in the chat. We'd love for you to check out the new graphic art, or the new graphic, what's the graphic design? Sorry, it's a comic book. So we'd love for you to do that. It's called First Woman, and check that out. Then we also have an awesome Artemis, Draw Artemis link. And there's a new book that was written called Are You Going? So there's three opportunities for you guys to get involved, and we really want you to. And if you do, please hashtag NextGenStemIt and make sure we see your awesome work. I'm going to turn it over to Samuel.
All right, everybody. So final thoughts here. Thank you so much for our participants. You guys are awesome. You all, ladies and gentlemen, amazing work here. We're truly honored to be here and, you know, and have you here on NASA STEM STARS. And we're just going to continue following this work and enjoy this upcoming launch. And for those out there, if you were unable to ask your questions for today's episode, please submit more using the hashtag NextGenSTEM, and make sure you share your mission challenge using that same hashtag and the Artemis hashtag. So thank you all, everybody who's watching us, who has supported us over this year. We truly appreciate support. We look forward to seeing you on season 3 in 2022. And go NASA and go Artemis.